all for coming, and it's a pleasure to have Professor Hugh Roberts, who is the Edward Keller Professor of North African and Middle Eastern History at Tufts University, Medford, Massachusetts, which is just across from Packard Avenue. It's a very wide avenue. People cross it very rarely. So you're very welcome here, and we hope you'll do it more often. We need you more here. And he's a fellow Brit. We occasionally rant together about the absence of a bar in the school. So maybe one day.
Frequently rant.
I see that.
It's the most important institution in the school. So he's been here since January 2012. And between 1976 and 1997, he was at the School of Development Studies at East Anglia and the IDS at the Institute for Development Studies at Sussex. And then he was at Berkeley, University of California at Berkeley, SOAS from 1997 to 2002, and LSE. So he's been around a bit everywhere, and then he was, and we miss him for that, because when he was with the ICG, we used to follow the International Crisis Group North Africa reports very, very carefully, because there is so little information and so few experts on North Africa in the English-speaking world, especially in the UK and in the US. So it's a privilege to have you here with us. And I love your title, Bye Bye Tufik. I've just come back from Argentina. I was in Argentina and I left on Sunday when they were having elections. And there it was Bye Bye Alberto Nisman. So Alberto Nisman was the prosecutor who either committed suicide or was murdered, depending on which side of the divide you are, because he was about to give a statement possibly incriminating the president with some shady business, which involves even Iran and Syria and Hezbollah, and it was quite a mess. And my conclusion was that all these repressive regimes and have a lot in common, and I'm looking forward to see if Algeria is the same also with Bye Bye Tufik. So,
thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here to be able to talk about my favorite subject, Algeria, to an interested audience. The title actually, I haven't had as much time as I would have liked to prepare this. I originally encumbered myself and your program with a very, very long title. I can't even remember what it was. It went something like Bye Bye Tufik, the dismantling of the Algerian security services, intelligence services, the Bouteflika presidency, and the succession crisis, or something like that. Anyway, I didn't have time to put all that on my... so that is actually a little unfinished. I'm talking about an event and then trying to sort of a recent event, the dismissal of Lieutenant General, which is the highest rank in the Algerian army, Lieutenant General Mohamed Lamine Medienne, widely known by his alias Tufik. He has been the overlord of the Algerian military intelligence services since 1990. He has accumulated more power in that role than any predecessor. This is the end of an era. His dismissal was announced on September the 13th last. It's a recent event. It didn't come as a complete surprise. It came really as the climax of a process that was visibly underway from the summer of 2013 onwards. He's really, in a sense, died a death of a thousand cuts. But it's nonetheless the end of an era. Since 1990, whenever I've gone to Algeria, I've really been feeling that I've been going chez Tufik, that he's been the security overlord, and what happened to me when I was in Algeria to some extent depended on his attitude to my being there. Since at any rate until relatively recently, certainly from 1992 onwards, the presence of foreigners was something that was subject to a very explicit and specific vetting and surveillance. So Algeria has changed at any rate, as far as I'm concerned. The question is, what does this mean? Why has this happened? What does it signify more broadly for Algerian politics? And so I'm going to, at any rate, suggest a number of things to begin the process of, if you like, unpacking this event. And in a way, I'm going to start close up, and sort of the camera will then withdraw and try to see things in a progressively wider frame. In the short term and in close up, this is the. I'll hang on to this if you don't mind. Sorry, but you can get rid of this. out of the trash. This is the provisional resolution of part of a kind of drama, which has had a melodramatic aspect, of a factional conflict. Algerian politics are unusually faction-ridden. I find myself meeting plenty of people who, like Nadim, want to say Algeria is just like Argentina, or at any rate, just like Lebanon, or just like Egypt. I cling, contre vents et marées, to the view that Algeria is actually like nowhere else. And of course, I may be wrong, but this is a premise of my analytical démarche towards understanding what goes on there. My view is that Algeria has unusually pronounced, extensive, and profound factionalism built into its political life, that this is actually the core of its political life. And there has been a three-sided faction going on for the last couple of years to do with the very acute problem of a triple succession. There has been the obvious question of the presidential succession, which has been on the agenda, at least in the views of many Algerians, for really quite a long time now. Bouteflika became president. I refuse to say that he was elected in 1999, and had a second term from 2004, and that was an important event in itself, that he secured a second term. Under the terms of the constitution, that should have been his lot. And it required very much in plain sight a blatant re-rigging of the constitution to enable him to have a third term in 2009. But I think very, very few Algerians thought there would be any question of a fourth term, and damn it, he got himself a fourth term in 2014, despite the fact that he was clearly by that stage a complete invalid. And I'll come back to that point in a moment. And so there has been the issue, which has been protracted and protracted and is still on there in people's faces, of the succession to Bouteflika. Bouteflika is kind of refusing to be succeeded, but sooner or later God is going to have to take him back, and someone else will have to occupy the presidential palace, and that remains on the agenda. And of course, it's a point that polarizes political maneuvering. But there's two other successions that have been on the agenda for the last two or three years: the succession to Medien, and the succession finally to the chief of the general staff, Lieutenant General Ahmed Gaid Salah. The point is that these are the three most important posts in the Algerian power structure, and they have all been held by aging, by gerontocrats, by increasingly unwell and implausible figures. And so there has been a triple succession, in effect, on the agenda. And that, of course, is a very dangerous fact. It's one thing when there is a presidential succession to be handled, if other power positions are held in a stable fashion by broadly plausible and competent people. The succession that has to be dealt with can be managed. But if all three of the top positions in the Algerian power structure are held by people who are in their late 70s or older, no one really knows, at least the public does not know how old Gaid Salah is.
The official CV says that he was born in 1940. I haven't met yet an Algerian who believes this. He's widely believed, perhaps wrongly, perhaps this is a canard, an innuendo, that he's widely believed to be at least as old as Bouteflika, if not older, and certainly older than Medine. Anyway, the point is that there's been this sort of cumbersome and inelegant dance of the gerontocrats, each of them apparently saying, after you. And none of them wanting to go first. And this is particularly poignant from the point of view of Medien, who has ended by doing the honors of going first, not that this is experience as an honor, because he's the youngest of the three, almost certainly. And it has traditionally been, in a way, the prerogative and function, amongst many other functions and prerogatives, of the military intelligence services to act as the effective arbiters of presidential successions. Medien has held the position that he's now been forced to give up since September 1990. He therefore was involved in arbitrating the succession to President Shadley, and the succession to the short-lived presidency of Mohamed Boudiaf, who was assassinated in 1992, and then the short-lived presidency of his successor, Ali Kafi, and then President Zerawal's succession, when Zerawal announced, taking people by surprise, that he intended to step down in the autumn of 1998. Medien has been a key fixer, and now the fixer has been fixed in a disconcerting and painful fashion. And the question then is, well, who is going to arbitrate the other two successions? Will the invalid president arbitrate the succession to the chief of the general staff? Or will the chief of the general staff arbitrate the succession to the invalid president? No one knows. The thing is up in the air. And while it offers grounds for amusement, I actually think that this is a dangerous moment in Algeria. So that's by way of introduction. We have these three apparatuses: the presidency, the regular army with its general staff as its top echelon, and the Mukhabarat, the military intelligence empire. What has been going on? Just for those of you who are not familiar with how handsome Algerians are, and I actually think they are very handsome. I think the Algerians are one of the most handsome people in the world. This is Bouteflika. Taken about, I would say, 15 years ago, when he was young and good-looking. This is a more recent picture following his hospitalization in Paris in the summer of 2013, following what was described as, I think, a stroke. Is perhaps the what you could call it, a stroke. And he spent many weeks in Paris, and these weeks were not politically idle weeks. It was assumed at that point that his stroke ruled him out of a fourth term. It was widely assumed that, therefore, that we were coming to the end of his presidency, and the question was, well, who will replace him? And it turned out that he didn't agree with that assessment and was determined to hang in there and has succeeded in doing so, which in itself is an event and an enigma. How on earth did Bouteflika manage, despite being visibly old and ill and infirm, and simply no longer up to the job, how did he manage to get a fourth term? That's part of the story we need to broach in considering why and how Toufik has had to accept Le Grand bye-bye. And here is Bouteflika with his younger brother, Saïd, who has been seen by many as the real power in the presidency, that Bouteflika has been the formal incumbent, but has for quite some time no longer really been running the presidency, that a great deal of the political management of the presidency's collective interest as an institution, the Bouteflika family's investment in it, is actually being handled by the younger brother, Saïd, the younger man on the left. So he's a player in this situation. And here is what was for many, many years the only image available of the mysterious, enigmatic Toufik. Now, since he's gone, suddenly a raft, well, not a raft, actually a rather impressively small number of other photographs have suddenly been put into circulation. But for many, many, many years, he was successful in ensuring that this was the only image available. And in fact, for the first decade, I would say, of his innings as head of the Mukhabarat, there were no images. Well, certainly for the first 5 or 6 years, there were no images. He no longer looks very much like that. Mm. Now, so those are our three main protagonists of this intimate struggle. We should bear in mind that there's long been fault lines between these characters. Medien was instrumental in organizing Bouteflika's return from many years in exile to become head of state in 1999. He wasn't, however, an enthusiast for it. He wasn't against it. He wasn't for it. There is a simplistic version that was put into circulation immediately in 1999 that Bouteflika was simply put in power by the army. This was not true at all. He was the candidate of one faction in the army. There was a faction in the army that was had reservations, if not actually was opposed to him becoming the new president, and therefore there was a need for a mediator within the army to organize a consensus within the officer corps. And arguably that is what Medien did. Without himself being an enthusiastic supporter of Bouteflika, he organized, if you like, the consensus of the top brass. In 2004, when the general staff was opposed to Bouteflika having a second term, Medien ended up tipping the balance and enabling him to have a second term. There was a split at that juncture between the general staff and the DRS, the DRS being the French acronym for Medien's intelligence empire, the Department of Intelligence and Security, Département du Renseignement et de la Sécurité. And the DRS sided with Bouteflika against the chief of the general staff, who was forced to retire, and taking with him his main supporters in the top echelon of the army. This was a purge of an important element of the officer corps, who made the mistake of opposing Bouteflika, thinking that they could pull it off. Bouteflika outwitted them and outmaneuvered them, and the intelligence services backed him. So in that sense, Medien was clearly an ally of Bouteflika's in 2004, whereas he had been much less implicated in the Bouteflika position in 1999. So what we've been seeing recently is the end of an alliance, definitive end. And this, of course, is something that happens from time to time in Algerian politics. Algerian government is predicated on alliances between different elements of the power elite, between different coteries and cliques and factions. And alliances never last forever. All good things come to an end. And this is a moment, therefore, that the Algerians call la recomposition des alliances. The alliances are being recomposed, a necessary but stressful moment in the Algerian political game. Okay, the alliance had clearly ended in 2010 when, having seen Bouteflika in for a second term in 2004 and much less enthusiastically agreed to this controversial third term in 2009, which involved monkeying around with the constitution, in 2010 the DRS appears to go to war with the Bouteflika presidency, mounting a big campaign against corruption that targets civilian ministers who were Bouteflika's boys, and above all, the Minister of Energy, Shakib Khalil, who is the overlord of the entire hydrocarbons energy sector and has a controlling managerial role in relation to Sonatrach, the state oil and gas company. And this turned into a colossal scandal. It was the end of the line for Khalil, who clearly had been caught out doing all kinds of unethical things, and it was very damaging to Bouteflika and seemed to be the first round of a DRS campaign to get rid of Bouteflika, to ensure that his third term would be his last. And what's remarkable, therefore, is that Bouteflika, or rather we should say the Bouteflika presidency, because there are two Bouteflikas in play at least, has managed to turn the tables on Medien's DRS. They took a hit over Khalil. They lost that piece on the chessboard, but they've been able to turn the tables and both secure a fourth term and get rid of Tufik. Now, how did this happen? It happens in conjunction with, I think that, are there any more pictures? Yes, we ought to bring in the third handsome Algerian, the chief of the general staff, Guy Salah. What happened was under the cover or benefiting or making a virtue of necessity of the hospitalization following his stroke in the summer of 2013, Bouteflika engages in political activity from his sickbed and organizes his counterattack against the DRS offensive. And on his return to Algeria in the late summer, the campaign begins. A key figure of the DRS is sacked immediately, Colonel Fauzi, who was in charge of the DRS's media apparatus, which had been suggesting in releases and stories inspired in the Algerian press that Bouteflika was out of the running for a fourth term. Fauzi is sacked as soon as Bouteflika is back in Algiers. And then much heavier hitting begins. The DRS itself begins to be dismantled. In the autumn of 2013, a major section of the DRS, the army security, the DCSA, the Direction Centrale de la Sécurité des Armées, which is a major subdivision of the DRS as a whole, is taken away from the DRS and attached to the general staff of the army, that's to say, comes under Gaid Salah's authority. Then, secondly, a less important but nonetheless important subdirection of the DRS that handles the investigation of corruption was also taken away from the DRS and attached to the general staff before being dissolved. And it was this body that had spearheaded the campaign against Khalil and the whole corruption thing, targeting Bouteflika's boys. Then we find the officer very close to Medienne, who had been in charge of the army security, which has just been reattached to the general staff. He himself is retired, General Jabba. He's forced into retirement. And then we find that the head of both of the other major subdivisions, internal security and external security, in other words, MI6, if you like, to use a British analogy, both of these are forced into retirement. Heads are rolling. Gosh. And this is all in the autumn and early winter of 2013. This follows a series of meetings in Algiers between Gaid Salah and Bouteflika in September 2013. There are several meetings that are reported on in outline. That's to say, General Gaid Salah visited the president today, end of story. But subsequently, we find out what they had been talking about. And it is a total carve-up of Medienne's DRS without Medienne himself being removed. So what has just happened on September the 13th this year is, if you like, the final act, the coup de grace. The bull has been tormented by the toreadors and the picadors, and finally the matador has stepped forward, and he is achevé, to use an appropriate French term. And Tufik is over and done with. Now, why? Now, clearly, the point about after you, the reluctance of these three narcissistic Algerian power players, all of whom, each of whom has his nif, his amour propre, which is an important motivator for any Algerian, as anyone who knows the country will know. There is a matter of personal ego and needle here. They're all coming, after all, to the end of their run. So in a way, there's a trivial aspect to the dynamics of this power play. But of course, much more is at stake. It's one thing that Bouteflika should insist that Tufik goes first. It's another thing that the entire military intelligence empire should be broken up. And in a way, that is perhaps the most important thing, or at least might appear to be the most important thing. So let me, I better take a look at my watch because I promised I wouldn't go on forever. I'm still okay, am I not?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, maybe another 5 or 10 minutes. This, it looks a very dramatic thing, the breakup of the DRS. So let's just think a bit about that. The DRS only existed since 1990. In other words, from 1962 to 1990, the arrangements were slightly different. And in a way, we see a kind of pendulum swing pattern here. From 1962, from independence, through to 1980, for the first, in other words, 17 and a half, 18 years of independence, the principle was the unity of all the military intelligence services. They were all came under one roof with one overlord, and that man was the legendary Kastimarba, to use his nom de guerre. It wasn't his real name any more than Tufik was Median's real name. But then, following the death of Boumediene and the advent of the Shadley presidency, we see a breakup of what had been long known as La Sécurité Militaire, which is its overall name, into a number of distinct services. And then in 1990, we see the dynamic of reunification. Medienne is the architect of the reunification of the military intelligence services under one roof with him as overlord. And now we're seeing once again the dynamic reversing and the breaking up. So there is a precedent for this. There is, one might even say there's a tradition of doing this at particular junctures. What is interesting is that this is being done prior to the presidential succession. The breakup of Kastimoba's military security in 1980 came after his political patron Boumediene had gone back to God and Shadley had taken over. It was in the context of a new regime that we find this being resorted to. What's interesting, it's in the context of a very old and failing regime that we find this breakup scenario being repeated. That's one thing we need to think about, but before we can think about it, we need to put it in relation to a number of other things. There's the question of what has actually motivated this beyond the reluctance of Bouteflika to allow Tufik to arbitrate his succession. And the answer is that there's also, there's been a problem for Tufik on both fronts. He's had a problem with the regular army, as well as with the presidency. He's had a problem with Gaid Salah. And this dates back to the decision in 2004 of the DRS to back Bouteflika's claimed for a second term against the general staff of the army. In other words, there is, if you like, a history of, you might call it rancor, within the regular army against the Mukhabarat. Now, this is not an unusual thing. One finds this in other regimes. I was particularly struck by the importance of this as a factor in the dynamics of Egyptian politics in the period leading up to 2011 and the first couple of years after the fall of Mubarak. Certainly at the time of the fall of Mubarak, this was a factor in the situation as I understood it in Cairo. Regular armies don't really like military intelligence people. It's not as if they do any... It's as if they're not really quite soldiers. On the other hand, they have all the, or most of the perquisites of military rank and so forth. And there's no doubt that that resentment of the DRS was something that the regular army, insofar as it felt this, or at least a lot of its commanding or senior officers felt this, links up with a broader popular hostility to, or at any rate, strong reservations about Medienne and his DRS. The point is that in the context of the terrible violence of the 1990s, the DRS massively expanded. Medienne became, in the estimation of many people, the most powerful man in the country. In the course of the violence of the 1990s, from 92 onwards, the counter-terrorism operations against the welter of different Islamic armed groups that went on right through to the end of the 90s, and of course has never completely stopped. There's has remained in being a low-level small scale, locally circumscribed terrorist activity. And there's no doubt at all that it was this, if you like, internal war emergency that enabled, that furnished the arguments for Medellin massively to expand his budget, massively to expand his staff, his power. And that this was something that obviously would not last indefinitely once, broadly speaking, peacetime conditions had returned. There's no doubt been a willingness going far beyond the presidency to clip the DRS's wings and clip Tufik's wings. And that's an element in the equation. And more broadly, within what passes for the civilian wing of the Algerian political elite, including the leaders of notionally opposition or dissident parties, an issue has been made in a rather unfocused way, but an issue has been made for the last few years of the excessive role and influence, presence of the DRS, that to the extent that well-known Algerian academics have been saying in print, in interviews in Algerian newspapers, things like, everybody works for the DRS. Mm-hmm. All my friends work for the DRS. You know, I mean, extraordinary statements like this, kind of outrageous statements that may well be exaggerated, but the point is that it had got to the point that it was safe to assume that whoever you were talking to was probably going to give a report on what you had said. It was not safe to assume the contrary. And I myself ended up thinking that certain long-standing friends of mine might well be on Medellin's payroll. You know, that thought began occurring to me, and of course it's not a pleasant thought. Mm-hmm. So there's been an issue of, if you like, the DRS becoming what in England in past years would be referred to as an overmighty power. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's part of it. What else? A second, there's a couple of other factors that I think one should factor in, and a place to begin is the observation that Bouteflika's counterattack against Medellin's DRS attack on the presidency starts in Paris. And however valid his medical reason for being in Paris, he's, as I said, he appears to have made a virtue of necessity and to have stayed in Paris for more than merely medical reasons. It is very striking that while he is in Paris, he is visited, I think I'm right in saying, by only two people from the Algerian political elite. His prime minister, Abdelmalek Salal, okay, there's a who needs to make a report, how things are going, it's a kind of playing a caretaker role at that at that point, and Guide Salah. He's not visited by any other senior figure, or it's not reported, but these visits are reported. And in other words, the Algerian presidency is actually functioning on French soil. Yeah. It's doing business. It's taking decisions. While a pensionnaire of Madame la France, this is an incongruous state of affairs, and I'm struck by how little commentary it has actually attracted, but I think it is not without significance. This happens in the summer of 2013, that's to say 6 months after a dreadful event in the Sahara, a terrorist attack on a major gas facility near In Amenas at a place called Tigantourin, where a convoy of some 40 armed to the teeth Islamic terrorists of some kind come out of the desert from the Libyan side, but according to one story had originated in Niger. There are several different versions, and I don't pretend to know the exact truth. And they take all the people at this place hostage, and the eventual intervention of the Algerian security forces involves, I think it was 39 foreign workers are killed in what appears to be a horrifically botched assault by security forces. And the DRS took the fall for this. The DRS was blamed for making such an unholy mess of this. And one theory about the logic of what has just happened is that it is Western governments who have insisted on Tufik taking the fall. There was a well-known Algerian commentator in September, immediately after the announcement that Toufik had said bye-bye, said Bouteflika has obeyed the Americans. This is Washington pulling a lever, getting rid of Toufik. Now, I'm not endorsing that interpretation. I'm just reporting that it's going the rounds. I'm more interested in the la piste française, given that it seems to me the key strategic decisions were taken much earlier and taken in Paris. Now, where does this point to? And of course, I know I'm starting a number of hares and not sort of chasing them very far, and it's up to you to sort of join the chase or orient me, because I'm going to end now. And then we can discuss further with your questions. I link this to several different aspects of what I consider to be the global problem of Algerian politics, which I refuse to accept as an insoluble problem, but I am beginning to accept that it's unlikely to be solved while I'm around to observe it, which is sad for me, but never mind. There is the problem of the relationship between the military and civilian wings of the Algerian elite, and more generally, the relationship of the military to Algerian political life in general, and the fact that civilian participation in Algerian political life remains cramped within constraints defined by the prerogatives of the military. That is a general problem. And with the role of the intelligence services being a specific and very important aspect of that general problem. There's also the problem of the relationship of, there's the problem of Algeria's relationship to the wider world and particularly to her Western partners, and the issue in that context of how much remains today of the sovereignty for which the Algerian revolution was fought. Algeria is not really a substantially sovereign state any longer. And it is no doubt in my mind that it has been a strategic objective of France since the end of the Cold War to reduce Algeria to a client state of La France. I have no doubt about this at all. Of course, people are free to disagree with me, but it has been a constant element of my reading of the overall position. My view is that the move against Toufik did represent at least a temporary alliance between the Algerian presidency and Algeria's main external partners, them being not only the French and the Americans, but also the British. The British were very audibly furious about the terrible event in Tighantourian, and immediately started raising the question of the need for reform of the Algerian security services, and began proffering British assistance in this regard. Now, such offers of assistance are never innocent, and that goes, of course, for all the Western powers. There is always un calcul. And I have no doubt at all that there has been a perception outside Algeria that while the DRS may have, in a sense, become an overmighty power from the point of view of Algerians inside the country, it has been a very, very important factor in Algeria's capacity to negotiate, to drive hard bargains with her Western partners. Mm-hmm. And that, therefore, Western interests, in the sense of the interests of individual Western governments, can expect to be served by a weakening of the DRS. The DRS has become something of a legend, and this is particularly important in the context of the endlessly mutating crisis in the Sahel. Algeria has been a major player in the Sahel. Algerian intelligence has been a crucial element of Algeria's own edge in relation to other players. There has been a concerted campaign trying to get the Algerians to agree to deploy their regular forces beyond Algeria's frontiers in security restoring or peacemaking or terrorism bashing, whatever, missions. And that requires Algeria to abandon what has been a constant principle ever since independence, Algeria's own refusal to intervene in the internal affairs of other countries. Algeria has consistently, however threadbare its nationalism may have ended up appearing, and it does seem pretty threadbare today, I remember what it looked like in the 1970s, Algeria has remained consistent on certain points of principle. One of them is defense of the principle of self-determination, opposition to external intervention in the internal affairs of any country. It opposed the intervention in Libya in 2011 on that basis. It's opposed all outside intervention in Syria on the same basis. Yeah. And it has refused to itself to become an instrument of such an intervention elsewhere, but has come under increasing pressure from in the Western media, from France, from Britain, from America, from Morocco, and so on, to lend itself to this role. And it's my belief that for all the things that the DRS can be reproached with, and the Median personally can be reproached with, and all kinds of dreadful things were done in the 1990s, and that hasn't really been my subject today, it has nonetheless tended to function as a bulwark of this old nationalist principle in relation to the question of intervention in other countries. And that may now come onto the agenda in a way that up until now it's been kept off it. And so I think that an important element of the story, that Bouteflika's success in hanging on to the presidency and getting rid of Tufik and breaking up the DRS has actually been conditional on external support, in Western support, in a big way. And I think that that is going to have all kinds of implications for the future. And those implications are going to are more likely to lead to greater turbulence than less turbulence. A striking feature of the, if you like, the aftermath, the coda since the Tufik's bye-bye on the 13th of September, there have been an unprecedented number of arrests within the officer corps of the army. Let me just mention a couple of them. There was one important arrest that happened just before, at the very end of August. The major general, that's the second highest rank in the army, Major General Hassan, who had been head of counterterrorism, was arrested, and he is in custody to this day. Other generals and colonels have been arrested. Others have been forcibly retired and have had their passports confiscated. They're not allowed to leave the country. There is something quite serious going on in the Algerian army. There is a faction fight mutating into a purge, and it's by no means clear what the eventual outcome of this will be. And one thing that has been striking is a number of senior retired officers have been speaking out and being reported in the Algerian press attacking Gaid Saleh, and basically in a way saying he does not, the sort of subtext or decoded is he does not speak for all the army. He is himself contested. And if it turns out to be the case that these dramatic changes have been premised on external Western support for a increasingly contested presidency inhabited by a clearly spent, exhausted president. It may well be that this is simply the latest round in what will turn out to be quite a protracted struggle for power, the eventual outcome of which, in my view, cannot be predicted. But I am myself now anticipating a period of fresh turbulence. And when senior officers of the army are being put in prison, this is virtually unprecedented. And it implies that all kinds of fault lines within the power structure are becoming very septic and being politicized in ways that are very dangerous. Maybe this is necessary for there to be a fundamental political reform leading in a more eventually hopeful direction. But this is, we're looking at a situation of gathering crisis, in my estimation. Let me leave it there.
Thank you. Well, I can already see many questions. I just wanted to say that, the mark of a good lecture on such a complex situation is when someone like me comes out thinking that he understands it less than when you started.
So this was my purpose.
This was your purpose. Yes. So I just want to shoot for on one thing. Is this a system crumbling internally, or is there a puppeteer? Is there someone? Is there Ali Abdullah Saleh or someone like that?
Is there a puppeteer?
Yeah, is there someone from inside doing that, or is it crumbling? No. So in which case you may see it, you may see the end of it sooner than you think.
Okay.
So that's what I don't understand. Is there like a strong figure in the background doing that?
No, there is no puppeteer. Crumbling is you're going too fast. This may be wishful thinking on your part, Nadim.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's crumbling. I think it's in crisis.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's crumbling. This is, for all its faults, and there are many, the Algerian, if we want to call it a political system, it has resources. Mm-hmm. And it has resources, and there are reflexes that will kick in at some point. There's no puppeteer. There's someone who appears to be trying to be a puppeteer, and that's the younger brother, Said Bouteflika.
Yeah.
He's clearly very resourceful, also audacious and clever. He's a schemer, apparently, a very thoroughgoing one. But my own view is that let's ask what do the Bouteflikas want? I'm on record. I was interviewed by an Algerian paper just a couple of weeks ago on this. The Bouteflikas are not going to retain the presidency. In other words, there is not going to be a family succession. Some people think there is, that it's going to be the Cuban scenario, the younger brother taking over. If that happens, then I think there will be civil war. Let me be a little bit more prudent. I think there will be a vigorous reaction in the Algerian body politic against that. Just as I was certain that there would be a vigorous reaction in the Egyptian body politic, such as it is, against a Gamal succession.
Yeah.
And so my own view is that the Bouteflikas must know this, and therefore this is not what they're aiming at. They're aiming for a deal whereby they get to pick their successor, and their successor is someone who guarantees that they will have a quiet life enjoying their ill-gotten or well-gotten gains thereafter, and their gestion of public affairs during the Bouteflika years will not be something to be investigated and attacked, and generally life made miserable for them in the aftermath of their period of glory. That's what they're looking for. The problem is, who can do that? Who can be the successor who is sufficiently legitimate in the perception of other key players, and for that matter, the Algerian public? One shouldn't underestimate the extent to which Bouteflika has been seen by many ordinary Algerians as a good president, has had popular support. The successor for it to work has to be a plausible one, has to be présidentiable. Whether or not Gaid Salah is sort of caressing the crazy dream of being that person at his age, clearly there are elements of the army who are already saying, don't even think about it. That's part of the subtext. Don't even think about it. You don't speak for us all. So who does that leave in? The answer is it almost certainly will have to be a civilian, but which civilian? And what civilian can claim to be capable of filling the shoes of a series of presidents, each one of which had revolutionary historic legitimacy, whereas no civilian now can claim to have been part of the revolution. That is part of the problem. In other words, we're back with the familiar problem of legitimation of high office. Somebody was raising that. Yes,
let me.
Yes.
So clearly what the Bouteflikas want is safety and not succession in some sense.
They want to control the succession in the interests of safety. Yeah.
Right. Why can't they just do a Marcos, leave the country? What do they care? Who and seek asylum wherever they can and enjoy their riches?
No. This leaves out the factor of nif,
right.
Amour prop. These are Algerians. Bouteflika was an officer of the Liberation Army. It's not only about him; it's about the family. They're not all going to go into exile. They want an honourable retirement in Algeria. Of course, they'll spend most of that in Paris and you know, Miami and wherever, you know, Aspen, and of course Dubai. But they don't want to be chased out of their country, jamais.
It's very interesting. But you at the beginning, you discounted the possibility of serious comparative work in terms of like the reference to Argentina and Lebanon, etc.
This is me challenging you, Lebanese.
That's right. No, but if I may just bring up a bit of a comparative dimension, looking at other gerontocracies, and by the way, when we looking at the ages of those protagonists, they all look almost like babies compared to the Saudis. The Saudis went right before the most recent changes. It was the age range was close to 90. Mm. So here in their mid to late 70s, they look like quite young. But beyond that, like if we, whenever we look at these kinds of systems of very old people, another interesting historical reference is Brezhnev in the final days of the Soviet Union, and at the time, he was generally regarded as some kind of a very passive puppet for the rest of the establishment. Now, when you were talking about Bouteflika, it sounded like he was still fully in control of his mental capacities, right, and his ability to maneuver politically. And the reason, my question is basically, is it, was he kept alive politically for reasons of maintaining the status quo among within the oligarchy, or was it his own maneuvers? And I'm asking that because not long ago when the French president met him, he did say something to the effect that President Bouteflika was perfectly coherent or something like that. So the bar was quite low in terms of his capacities. So what's your take on that?
Well, I think that is consistent with my thesis that France are keeping it going. But there's a pay, you know, there's a quid pro quo. France is getting something strategic in return, whereas Algeria isn't getting anything strategic in return. It's the Bouteflika family that's getting something strategic in return for the short run. But otherwise, yeah, your point is well taken. But your question was
so about Bouteflika himself. Has he been kind of maneuvering? He himself, is it his brother, or is it he?
Well, this is the intimacy of the Bouteflika family, and we cannot peer in there into that space.
But he was not simply a passive.
No, I don't think he's passive. I mean, the point is when he was. One can't say he was running for a fourth term because he didn't go out of doors. He didn't make a single speech. He was not present at a single meeting. There's no doubt that all the sort of or most of the heavy lifting in terms of all the complex secondary decision making is being handled by Said. But Bouteflika, the elder brother, is nonetheless conscious of what is happening and is in agreement with it. I don't think he's inert or a prisoner. Mm-hmm. I think that the meetings, but I mean, it's conceivable I'm wrong and that he's, you know, in a coma all the time, but he doesn't appear to be, Hollande's testimony to that he is coherent when he absolutely has to be. You can see that it's a kind of a drama and kind of a melodrama, and you can see that this is not something that carries conviction with the Algerian public at all. Affectionate as many of them have felt towards him as the man who, to use his own terms, put the fires out, ended the worst of the violence. the timing of just to sort of add in or emphasize in answer to you the extent to which we've been seeing careful and intelligent and ruthless strategic thinking here. The key thing about the offensive against the DRS in the autumn of 2013 was it totally destabilized Tufik at that juncture without getting rid of him. It destabilized him and thereby ruled out the DRS organizing a consensus within the army and the broader elite in favour of anyone other than Bouteflika for the fourth term. It guaranteed Bouteflika's fourth term. He didn't need to give a single election speech on the hustings. He had already knocked the necessary arbiter out of the ballpark. That's the function of the initial offensive against the DRS. If there was to be a new president, a post-Bouteflika president in 2014, some rapid and strenuous work needed to be done to organize the consensus in support of that. The only person who could have done that was Medien, and Medien is holed under the waterline in September or October 2013. Do you see the point of it? That explains the timing. So, in a way, who cares whether it's Abdelaziz or Said who is doing the mental work here? They're a tandem. It's the Bouteflika presidency. It's of, it's of no real import which of them is actually making the call now. They've clearly got a game plan and it's working for them for the time being. Yeah. But, wait for the reactions. The reactions have begun to come. And I'd be surprised if more don't come.
So it's a Bouteflika both on the top of the ticket and the bottom of the ticket.
Say that all again.
It's a Bouteflika on the top of the ticket and the bottom of the ticket. It's both brothers.
Yeah, but the point is, as I say, I don't think they can hang on to the presidency for much longer. Well, I think the best they can hope for is a negotiated exit that guarantees them. But that leaves the problem, who succeeds?
Yeah.
Thank you, Hugh. You should make audiobooks.
I believe one is being made, isn't it?
Yes.
I'm relying on the Forest Center and I'll expect a percentage of the profits.
To continue the tradition then, I wonder if you think that in this transition period, which is highly uncertain and probably will foster instability, Algeria may play a role in the region outside the borders, as you seem to point out. I mean, there is one of its neighbors that is calling for intervention. And also, I wonder if you think that Rampam Lamamra may play a role in the transition in Algeria. He was just visiting Oulon 2 days ago.
In a way, the second question is a little easier for me. Rampam Lamamra is the foreign minister, he was at one point the Algerian ambassador in Washington. And then he returned to Algiers and was running as Secretary General, the Foreign Ministry, for quite a while. And then he was the ambassador to the African Union. And he's a very able diplomat. And he's good news from that point of view, given that for quite a while, Algerian diplomacy seemed to be going downhill, partly because Bouteflika wouldn't allow any of his diplomats to do anything much. He wanted to be, in a sense, his own foreign minister, having been foreign minister under Boumediene and under Ben Bella. Lamamra, I think, is one of the most interesting and competent civilian figures in the Algerian power structure. So, yes, I am expecting him to have an important role to play in the years to come. That's as far as I can go. I mean, you thinking that something more is being put together, that he might conceivably be l'homme providentiel, the civilian who's plausible at the presidential level? Well, of course. Hollande's blessing may not be enough, you know. but Rampam Lamamra is an impressive figure, a name to watch, let's agree that much. He's also a Kabyle from the largest Berber element of the population. Medienne was a Kabyle, so not that the Kabyles particularly identified with him, but there's the question of Kabyle participation is always a consideration. Sorry, we cut you off. The other question, I don't pretend to know, of course. I don't pretend, I don't consider myself well-placed to gauge the balance of probabilities of Algeria finally abandoning its position of principle and agreeing to deploy its armed forces beyond its frontiers. I don't think that argument is over by a long way. And is it your view that it's necessary to resolve the Libyan thing? That tends to suggest that only force can resolve the Libyan impasse. Well, that's where we've ended up in Libya. At that's another conversation.
Okay. So
we're done.
No. Just one more. One more. What? There's a music happening. What about an Algerian spring? I mean, could we get a surprise that people get unhappy, or is the economy doing so well?
No, the economy is not doing well at all. Of course, it's suffering. The oil price has gone down, and this is another pattern repeating itself, as in the mid-80s, when you had the vertiginous drop in the oil price, which also had a knock-on effect on Algeria's gas prices. Algeria's export revenues plummeted, and this made a huge dent in the Shadli, it was then the President Shadli regime's whole pitch to the Algerian people, which was basically, we're no longer giving you any uplifting ideas to enthuse over, but we are giving you a better standard of living. And then it was, we're now giving you a worse standard of living. And you can understand why 3 years later you have massive nationwide riots against a regime that was seen as worse than useless, but which managed to survive thanks to Paris. Who were determined to ensure that Shadli got a third term, even though he was being vomited by the Algerian population. Not for personal reasons, but because his regime had simply been a failure. So the fall in the oil price has, this is sort of common ground amongst all commentators, it's ended the Bouteflika presidency's strategy of buying social peace. It can't do that. It was able to do that when its neighbors were encountering Arab Springs. The Algerians didn't have an Arab Spring. Part of the reason was the petrodollars, the huge cushion that enabled the regime to throw money all over the place. A much more important reason was that the Algerians had actually been on a learning curve right through the 90s and were absolutely clear they did not want any further adventures. They were not disposed to engage in any kind of revolutionary style revolt against the status quo. The Algerians have moved on from that kind of utopian millenarian outlook. They don't know what to do, and that's a measure of the uselessness of the so-called political parties that exist in Algeria. They're all rubbish, and none of them has a serious reformist strategy at all. So Algeria is currently a country in a very dangerous situation of being a country without perspectives. And so things could go wrong and you could get local disputes sparking things, but the most likely source of a dynamic leading to a major upheaval would be, in my view, an exacerbation of the factional conflict within the regime, which could be in the cards, rather than a revolt from below. I don't see a revolt from below happening at all, as things stand.
Great. Thank you so much. And please join me in thanking you. So would it crumble on its own?
You wanted to crumble, Nadia.
I wanted to crumble, yes.
And I'm not going to let it crumble. You see,
okay.
This is the point.
Hold your breath.
It's not going to crumble.
No.
No.
But it cannot continue like this forever.
No, nothing can.
And there's no alternative inside.
There's no visible alternative. And this is, of course, where people engage in guessing and wishful thinking. You've got a politicized army. A politicized army where the top echelon is not uncontested. That is both a dangerous situation, but it's also a situation that has potential.
Yeah.
What I wouldn't rule out is if the succession leads to, is botched, I wouldn't rule out that very Algerian thing, a coup that is, to use Boumediene's term, un redressement révolutionnaire, a revolutionary redressing of the situation.
Harakat al-sahihiyya.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That is always a possibility because, the one thing that remains politicized is the army. I'm not saying I expect this to happen, but I'm saying it's something that is in the Algerian toolbox, right? It's in their repertoire. They haven't exhausted their repertoire. But I think that there is also a possibility of a soft landing through one or two civilian figures coming to terms with each other. I mean, there are one or two or three or four serious civilian figures around. The problem is they tend to be at sixes and sevens as heads of rival parties and so on. But I mean, Ahmadou Yahya, who's an old veteran, he's been prime minister three times. He's another Kabil. He's a very able person. There's no, and he's a civilian. You know, he's a very able person. You shouldn't count him out of the play. He's a player, and he's someone who could be part of an intelligent compromise way forward. There are a number of other figures one could mention. Another former prime minister, Ali Benflis, is a player. Now these are. They're in their 60s, which of course makes them look like teenagers, you know. They've got a long innings ahead. So, I mean, it's not desperate. It's a situation of gathering crisis, but it's not a desperate situation. It's delicate and problematical. But I'm expecting more turbulence rather than less. And the sort of lull that Algeria's been going through, at least appears to have been going through, while everywhere else has been going to the devil, Algeria's been sort of just kind of cruising along. Yeah. That lull is now over. I think when senior generals are being arrested, something serious has begun to happen. So watch this space.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, does this look like Argentina? This is what we now need to discuss.
It looks more like a university. I think almost as complex.
It looks like Tufts. I've been saying this to my colleagues in the history department ever since I got here. Tufts looks so like Algeria. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
No.
Has there been any institutional changes within the military itself? Such as the mandatory requirement of being 18 months or serving 18 months, has that been lessened or lengthened or anything else along those lines?
It's possible that it has. There has been an issue. You're talking about national service.
National service, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there has been, but I forget where they ended up. Okay. To be honest, that's something that I've I kind of noticed out this, the edge of my eye. I'm not sure whether they actually took a decision. It was certainly been moot. It's been mooted and debated. And I think there's been an element pressing for reducing national service, wanting an entirely professional army. And that actually is not new. It was something that came in that was being raised as an issue. It was actually being raised as an issue at the very beginning of the Bouteflika presidency. And that's something that connects, actually. The issue of national service is not a trivial one. It connects with both the faction fight for control of the army, and it connects with the perception of key interested outside players, particularly France. And the reason why is that national service was originally seen as part of the nationalist project, having a nation building function, and as something also that tends to maintain or at least preserve formally the P in the acronym ANP, that's to say the popular dimension of the Algerian army, l'armée nationale populaire, and to reduce national service has been perceived by people on the nationalist wing of the Algerian political and military elite as an assault on these things, with some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not a trivial issue, but I can't pretend to be totally on top of where it is at the moment. I'm not sure that it's been resolved.
I just find it interesting because you see places like Turkey right now where you have maybe a little bit more of an extremist viewpoint with Erdogan, and what we saw this past year is that he's been defanging the military through the same kind of thing where he took 40 general officers. Let's take them out.
There is a bit of a parallel here.
He reduced military service from 18 to 24 months to 6 to 12 months, and he's transferred all the power to the gendarme, which is the military Ministry of Interior equivalent, which I don't think there is a good equivalent here, which is probably the DRS.
This is most interesting. I thank you for drawing this to my attention, because there are parallels here. And there is a gendarmerie in Algeria.
Yeah.
But the gendarmerie in Algeria is part of the army.
It's part of the army, not the DRS.
Well, the DRS is part of the army.
Oh, sorry.
Everything is part of the
army. No, not everything. The national police, the Sûreté Nationale, they're civilian. They come under the Ministry of the Interior, except that, well, actually here I have to backtrack, because the commander of the Sûreté Nationale is an ex-militaire.
There you go.
A major general, and the attempt by Bouteflika's right arm ally, the then interior minister Zerhouni, 5 years ago, to ensure that it was not a military man who was took over as the next director of the Sûreté Nationale, he was defeated, and Bouteflika was told by the army it has to be one of us, and Bouteflika said, okay, but I get to choose which, and they said, all right, deal. So he chooses someone from his home region.
Mm-hmm.
But interestingly, the gendarmerie, there's a story in today's our press today that the gendarmerie in Algeria is taking over from the DRS in a function that was previously the DRS's monopoly, namely providing security for the Algiers book fair. Algiers has a jolly good international book fair. It really is, you know, fair play to it. It's a good thing, and I encourage it. And there's a flourishing of Algerian publishing houses, you know, and it's a good event. But the DRS has been discreetly but effectively providing security for years, and now it's the gendarmerie, and this. This is like, you know, getting elephants to replace elves, you know, in terms of how they go about things. I'd be interested to see what my friends in the Algerian literary circles make of this. But I'm very struck by what you've just said about Turkey.
So there are three things that make this crisis...
It clearly isn't going to stop. I
mean, get him another sandwich.
So three things that make...
I mean, there's a class at 1:30, so that's why we sort of break, but we can continue forever.
Well, no, not forever. No.
With pleasure.
So I was just thinking about the crisis versus crumble scenarios that both of you seem to be, on either side of the spectrum of. And both of them seem worrisome when I look at three factors. One, the median age in Algeria seems to be 27 and a half years. Greater than 65% of all of Algeria is under 50 years of age. And the two biggest employers are the oil and natural gas industry and the military.
Mm-hmm.
And with the oil prices doing what they're doing, it's a perfect recipe for very disenfranchised, young, frustrated people that could be a cause for worry.
Well, the point is that you get flare-ups like you had in January 2011. There were 6 days of rioting in January 2011 that were precisely the angry young men in the streets with no prospects, no future, no girls, no jobs, nowhere to live, blah, blah, blah. And it was very ugly, and it went nowhere. It was completely apolitical. And it burnt itself out. And the point is that no political forces with any kind of agenda of contesting the regime, but in the name of some better idea, none of them touched it. None of them could touch it. None of them had any purchase on these guys. These guys are outside politics. And they're not interested in politics. The Algerian regime has actually succeeded beyond its wildest dreams. It's surrounded itself, and I gave a paper a few years ago at the Kennedy School arguing that the Algerian opposition are actually buttresses of the status quo. That's exactly what they are. These are all pseudo-parties with actually nothing to offer but a lot of hot air, making issues of secondary matters, such as identity issues. Ordinary, angry young Algerians couldn't give a damn about identity. They want jobs, they want futures.
Right.
And the point is that, so all the forces that are organized as, in some sense, political organizations, parties, None of them have anything, any connection with the potentially angry, revolting youth. None whatever.
So by that logic then, a ground-up revolution, if I were to call it an Arab Spring 2.0, there seem to be all the ingredients there, and if the oil prices continue to remain what they are for the next 18 to 24
ingredients
months...
Ingredients of what? Ingredients of
young,
what?
Frustrated,
No, you've got the ingredients, but what pudding are you going to make out of this?
You can't say revolution. You can't say, because that wouldn't happen. We've already seen.
I mean, are you telling me there could be yet another fruit vendor who would not immolate himself or herself?
No, people are immolating themselves all the time in Algeria. it's continuing.
Oh, okay. So
no, people are burning themselves, and it's leading nowhere.
Yeah.
There have been probably, I've stopped counting, but I would say there's probably been at least 50
really
suicides in Algeria, immolation, over the last 4 years. They've gone unreported. They're reported in the Algerian press.
Yeah. Lack of imagination.
No, it's the... Well, what do you mean lack of imagination?
Oh, I mean, come on, it's
you
been
just
done...
You just
know
yourself, I guess.
Yeah.
Excuse me, what do you say? Is there no political, no religious factor that could pick up...
But you see, the Algerians have tasted every single possible variety.
Yeah.
And it's all turned sour.
But
jihad, we've done it. It didn't work. And why? Because the Algerian army are even bigger bastards than we know how to be. They will ultimately crush us. We don't know how to unite in jihad anyway. That was they're all kinds of sort of. They're not going to go through that again. And as for a reformism, of this sort of the Muslim Brother variety, well, the Algerian Muslim Brothers, also known as the MSP, they've had their chance, and they've turned out to be a massive sort of flop. So it's and certainly the kind of Islamism that you expect an angry revolt to morph into, it's not going to happen. There's no receptacle for it unless the regime itself provides one and concocts a sort of false one just to sort of channel something into a kind of cul-de-sac. And I think the Algerians know this. I may be slightly overstating this, but I actually think there is a real problem that they feel they've tried or tasted everything.
Mm.
Actually, they haven't, but they don't know that there's one thing that has not been seriously tried or tasted.
Mm-hmm.
But they, unfortunately, are not interested in it.
Which is?
Reform. I'm serious.
They don't know it exists.
No, they.
Is it a known unknown or an unknown unknown?
If you look at Algerian political history in the 20th century, because modern Algerian history begins, the political history begins around the time of the First World War.
Right.
The ventures in reformism, i.e., seeking through non-violent, broadly legal constitutional procedures, partial. Redress of grievances, changes in conditions. Every one of those failed. They failed. They were all up against the French and the colonial status quo, and they were intelligent and reasonable and sincere and lucid, and they were all unsuccessful. The Algerians have not got in their collective memory a single memory of a successful venture in reform. Except reform in the religious sense of Islam, the Islamic reform of the Salafi reformers in the 30s and 40s, which was about purification of the religious field. That's a different issue. But there is not a single memory of a démarche réformiste, of a strategy of partial, gradual, step-by-step addressing particular grievances, getting a change there, and then moving on to the next one. And I have been arguing this with my Algerian friends for a long time, and I'm very struck by how allergic they are to this idea. They don't want, they're not interested in it. They unfortunately are the prisoners of a history that leaves them wanting, they insist on being radical. They insist on rupture. They're impatient and they're radical. Algerians are by definition radical and in practice impatient. And they are not prepared to conceive of anything that requires them to think in terms of steps and stages. That's what Tunisians do, except of course the Tunisians who did that with Bourguiba to get independence then turned out to be very competent revolutionaries 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And the Algerians need to learn to be competent reformists.
Mm-hmm.
They did their revolution 50 years ago, but they can't emancipate themselves from its memory. That's an important problem in my view.
I have one last question. So if this is like, you know, in a Western cowboy movie where in a saloon everybody's drawn and everybody's got a gun on it, on
what
it's called
the Mexican, the
it's called Tennessee standoff or whatever.
Or Tennessee standoff.
Yeah, then the
Tennessee standoff. I like that. Right?
Yeah. then when
everybody's got their guns out.
Everybody's
that's a very Algerian situation.
Yeah. And so in a situation like this, the person who survives is the weakest because everyone who's strong has more than one gun over them. You see that. So you get the weakest,
that's
most
a, that's an interesting game theoretic
most
right
most
there.
Inoffensive person. I mean, I think that's the way Ben Ali came to power in Tunis, because he was the least offensive, and even
is
I
that
think
what
Mubarak,
they meant when they said Mitchell inherited the earth?
Mubarak, yeah. And Mubarak came to power in the same way because he was also the least threatening on that. So
that's
if
a, that's a political theory saying incompetence rises to power.
Absolutely.
Well, yeah,
yes. Yeah. It is. It's the least.
Yeah.
So when
upwards.
In a situation like this, all the people who have power
and know how to exercise it will be knocked out.
Will be knocked out because they're all fighting each other, and the person who's forgotten on the sideline. So I think even Sadat was
yeah.
A
Sadat.
Sadat, Mubarak, Ben Ali. So if that's a
so what gives them the staying power?
No, because
no,
people
they
forget them. They don't look threatening to anyone.
But then they've all gone and stayed for decades on in
yeah.
Their positions.
Why don't you
yeah. Get
so who's the inoffensive character who may
yes,
survive this in Algeria? You know, if this is what's happening, if this is a good description of
the problem is that you don't. There's no vice president. See, don't forget Sadat, because he's inoffensive. Nasser makes him vice president because
mm-hmm.
he's vice president at the right moment. He becomes president.
Right.
Similarly with Mubarak. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like
now,
General Ford or something.
Yeah, but there's no vice president, because they always refuse to have a vice president. Oh, yes.
Okay.
So
that makes sense.
You haven't got the safe mediocrity in this key position
yeah.
that can succeed. It's just
yeah.
not there.
Yeah.
And whoever is functioning as, if you like, the deputy or the vice to the to Gaid Saleh, we don't know. The person who's taken over what's left of the DRS is a bloodstained thug,
mm.
He's by reputation, so he's not in any, there's no question of him being a contender for the presidency. So, General Tata.
Okay.
Now, this is why I think one is beginning to think in terms of the more prominent former prime ministers,
yeah.
Including the current prime minister, mm. Salal, who has mm. been on the whole, a reasonable success.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't made too many enemies. He has upset the Shawis 18 months ago. They're the Berbers in the southeast.
Right.
Unnecessarily, he said something stupid. But he happens to be a Kabyle from Constantine, so he's an Easterner. Some Kabyles would support him, and some Easterners would support him. Uyahya, three times prime minister, Kabyle, but a safe pair of hands, Kabyle, Lamamra. There are competent civilians, but they're competent as servants of the state. They're not really politicians.
Mm.
They're au commis d'état.
Subservient to the state.
Well,
yeah.
They are servants of the state who know how to, they are elite
mm-hmm.
functionaries. I would say the best of them, in the sense of the one who is most politically competent, is Uyahya. Uyahya is 63.
Oh.
Young. I mean, young enough.
He's
not a spent
yeah.
force by any means. He's got another decade in him, certainly.
Yeah.
There may be... The question I'm asking myself, we looked at those three prima donnas all sort of, sticking it to each other. And that's an important point I should have made a little earlier. It's a bit of a significant change from the syndrome that operated from 92 onwards, which was what the Algerians called the Black Cabinet, le Cabinet Noir, the secret conclave of the top power players who would get together and decide the next move, and that would frequently be decide who's the next person to be president. I mean, they functioned as the effective electoral college.
Yeah.
It was le Cabinet Noir, whose membership was known only to its membership, who decided who the Bouteflika was to be the next president. Now, clearly, we knew he was the chief of the general staff, the head of the DRS, and various other generals, but you end up speculating as to precisely which generals are in and which aren't. Now, the point is that that seems to have been effaced. It seems to have ceased to function. And in a situation of crisis, one thing I would be expecting is a new Cabinet Noir to spring up. Needs must. And in that context, if you've got the top officers, the commanders of the military regions, and the main surviving figures in the intelligence apparatus whose positions are not personally contested, and one or two elder statesmen on the civilian wing, former prime ministers and so forth, if they begin meeting without, of course, any constitutional mandate. They just begin meeting because they're powerful people and the government must carry on, and so Algeria is in their hands. That is one thing I'm kind of expecting to happen. And if it does, they could then decide, one thing they might decide is, well, we've run out of revolutionaries, of historics, it's no longer good for the army to be in the front line, we've always said this, so we need a civilian. And we've got a limited choice, but they're not useless. And they might just consider that this is the time actually to put a cabal in the presidential palace. Mm-hmm. There's never been a cabal. Mm-hmm. There have been Easterners with Bouteflika and Ben Bella. There have been Westerners with Zerawal. You've had Shawis, a Shawi Berber. Mm-hmm. There's never been a cabal president. They could just decide, well, actually, Yahya is a plausible president and a cabal, two birds with one stone. They could decide Lamamra is the guy who fits that bill, which he does formally. Or they could decide Salal does.
If there's a day.
If there's what?
If there's a day.
A day?
You're saying they could decide, but we're not even sure there is such a...
In a Tennessee standoff, there is not a day. There's one last man standing is his point.
Oh.
Yeah. Or the other thing, the other image is... In the Hitchcock movie, when you have the man, when you have the man sitting in the train in the compartment and just staring like this and moving when the train goes, and not talking to anyone, and then when the train reaches, everybody gets off and he's still sitting like this, and then the conductor comes and taps him on the shoulder and he keels over and he's already dead for a long time and nobody realized it. So is it possible that the system is dead?
Isn't Nadine's penchant for wishful thinking revealing? You want Algeria to crumble and die?
No, I think
I
the change.
I think
change is. I think change is inevitable.
Change is inevitable.
And I want to be optimistic in that it will happen on its own rather than through a civil war or.
So do I.
Yeah, that's.
I'm kind of waiting for the Black Cabinet to come back because I think it's needed.
So the best scenario is the worst one.
That's not the worst one. That's a scenario of pragmatic continuity.
Recycle.
The point is that you don't have the political forces that you require for a democratic transition yet. You just don't have them.
Remains to be seen.
Believe me, you know, the Islamists are basically, the sort of political constitutionalists are basically a busted flush. The Berberists are a busted flush.
Yeah.
You know. What is that? Trotskyists. Well, they're regarded as a bit of a busted flush, too.
They still have Trotskyists?
Yes. They have a splendid lady, Louisa Hanoum.
So they didn't turn neocon, like our Trotskyists?
No. Louisa Hanoum is the antithesis of a neocon. She's still a Trotskyist. I mean, Trotskyists are, of course, bad enough, but she is an honourable Trotskyist, and she's taking the line, you know, we need to strengthen our army at this point.
That
was great.
I thought the only Trotskyists were in Berkeley.
This is me.
Oh, thank you.
Because I know.
It's not the first talk I'm doing.
Right, but I also think that it's taking over the same work.
And the money is bigger, you know.
Some of the same things.
Do you ever come to things like Kelly Israel?
All the time.
Well, I've given talks
there. Yeah, so it could be that.
In a desert where you have oil wells in a very spread out, it's very easy.
It's, you know, Morocco being kind of next door, you know. It's interesting to see some of the parallels across a lot of the differences.
It requires a very broad
political
angle.
And so it's very, very interesting. And so, I think you're very articulate with, and I love your sense of humor. I think you're the irony in all of it.
Well, you know, one has to have a laugh at some
exactly. It's just like, oh my gosh. But we never know about the dark horse. We never know who may actually show up and rise up. So
sure.
I think that's kind of an interesting observation to see what happens. Nice to see you. I'll see you again. Yeah. Are you here now?
I'm
here.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
I'm in the history department.
Yeah,
and you're based here?
Yeah.
Okay,
I'm based, I'm based like in the greater Boston area.
Okay. Well, you will find me here.
Excellent.
Okay.
Take care of yourself.
You had a question?
Yeah, I had a question.
You might come up with
it. Really great. Thank you very much.
I'm a single payer.
I'm a senior in the
But on his phone he can download Viber.
He doesn't have a smartphone.
Oh, he doesn't.
Smartphones actually came out the last 2 years.
Okay.